Hello, welcome back to Let's Play Pillars of Eternity Blind. I am the RPG Chick. We are in Gilded Vale. We've explored most of it. Last episode, we finished looking at the Black Hound Inn. We went in Offer's house. We looked through these farms and stuff. And we're about to head into Ingroed's house. We'll check out the smithery. And the windmill. I'm sure we'll have time for all that. Perception affects the character's chance to cause interrupt like that. Interrupt. Nanton. Isn't Nanton the guy we came across in, the Veilwood? This man and woman appear to have been deep in conversation, working at closing two bulging satchels. They move to embrace until the woman notices your approach and pauses, her smile faltering a little. We are in their house.
Hail and well met.
Can we help you? She looks to her companion, brows furrowing with confusion. Do you know this woman, Nanton? Doesn't seem like she should actually be saying hail and well met like that. Nanton coughs. Yes, I think we met in the Veilwood. I warned her about the bear. He inclines his head. Glad to see you've made it. Is there something else you wanted? Well, I had a sixth sense vision about the bear in which it killed me in 2 seconds, so decided not to go in there. They lost a friend? You two seem to be in a hurry. Yes, I imagine so, Ingroed laughs. We're packing for a trip, actually. I've been meaning to visit Defiance Bay, and she looks at Nanton. Well, in truth, I think I've had my fill of this town. Nanton reaches to take her hand. It's time for some new scenery, he says. Is there anything you can tell me about Gilded Vale? Ingroed smiles wryly. Only that you want to be moving on as soon as you can. You've seen the tree, I imagine, but the rot goes deeper. If you were looking for work, I'd say you have a better chance of it elsewhere. We're headed for Defiance Bay ourselves, Nanton adds. Oh, goodbye. Chance encounter, huh? Ooh, the Dyrwood Part 2. The Broken Stone War. Don't mind if I do. In 2626 AI, a group of farmers, while clearing farmland for planting, accidentally knocked down one of the ancient Adra menhirs on their land. This innocent act drew the ire of the native population and started what would come to be known as the Broken Stone War. When it was finally over, several thousand colonists have been killed, as well as hundreds of the Glamfellens. Even though the war was technically over, the Glamfellens escalated their attacks on the settlers over the next 2 years, using vicious tactics that left many colonists, several military figures, an earl, and 6 thanes dead. Unable to stop the Glamfellen attacks, the earls elected Earl Edrang Hadret to the position of Greff. Well respected and known to be a master of military tactics, he was tasked with dealing with the Glamfellen threat. Edrang fought with the Glamfellens, led by an Orlan named Regd, for the next 2 years. Neither side can gain the upper hand on the other, resulting in a tense stalemate between the two groups. Because of this stalemate, the hostilities slowly died off, and in 2631, the Dyrwooden people signed a treaty with the Glamfellens. Regd would step down, the Glamfellens would stop their attacks altogether, and the Dyrwooden people would leave the ruins alone. This treaty angered the nobility in Edir, as it brought to a halt the supply of artifacts. Edrang also tried to get the practice of slavery outlawed, but this was not successful. Because of this, the peace between the Dyrwood and Ir Glanfeth is uneasy and tumultuous. Small patches of rural violence still cropped up, but were easily dealt with as neither side wanted another war. Why is there a quote at the end? A double quote at the end. Sure why that's there. So that in there. Thank you very much. What's in here? Don't mind if I do. Is anyone gonna, like, attack me because I take this stuff? There doesn't seem to be any danger of that happening. This bottle of Sunreed is half empty. Well, game, you're quite the pessimist. I say it's half full. As your party grows in size, you may want to change their formation. You can use the formation button on the main HUD to cycle between stuff. I want to go down in there to get that.
No problem.
I'm glad. Did I talk to him? Theophalion? Oh boy, got another one. You see a pennant waving tall and sluggish in the wind, a rising sun embroidered on the banner, the vanguard of a small troop of paladins. The atmosphere is buoyant, if restrained, and their armor has not yet been tarnished by the elements. This expedition is fresh, young, filled with zest and zeal. At their head stands a commander, awkward in full armor, but determined in step. Despite the excitement of his fellows, he does not smile. There's a twist to his mouth, his countenance grim. He throws up a hand, halting his troop. Silence falls among them, revealing a dark thunder, deep and low. He orders them to ready their weapons and spread out. Eyes dart from horizon to horizon, necks twisting to see the source of the sound. In the distance, dust and lightning rise from the ground as Stygian clouds race toward them overhead. The soldiers stand, only the staccato movement of their breath betraying their nerves. The commander closes his eyes, a blessing down on his troop. Invigorated, invincible, they wait as the enemy draws closer, poised to attack. People are going to wonder why we just stand by them and just do nothing. I saw someone go into the temple. Papa says we're not supposed to. Yeah, it was nighttime when we were here last. So someone's in there, huh? Beneath the vines are crude carvings of a sun rising over three stars. So where's this goodie? Settler's arrow. Is that new? I can't remember all this stuff. No. Yeah, I've got a few of them. Back with the blacksmith. Black Hammer Smithery. Some creatures and armor types are especially resistant or vulnerable to specific damage types. Commoner. Oh, hello. I'm just browsing. That shifty little Orlin better watch himself. If I work a few extra shifts at the inn, I can get one of those daggers. Speak to Master Tutano if you want something. You hear those bells? Guess it's bad news. usually is. Hold up. I mean, I know we have the autosave actually, but. Scale armor. You can hotkey any ability. Well, that's handy. I just want to look at this stuff then. Ooh, a wand. Two-handed. As magical implements often lack serious power compared to bows, crossbows, and firearms, the wand's flexible damage types help wizards deal with heavily armored opponents more easily. Wands are easily distinguished from scepters by their tapered points. Hmm. Aren't they loaded with spells? Scale armor is made of overlapping small plates of metal or horn sewn to a leather backing. It offers a balance of protection and speed. Is that what we have? She has mail, which is 9. Oh, mail's better. Okay. Dented and dull, these swords look ready for the forge. I don't suppose we can take anything from here either. Ale, rice, and a hammer and chisel.
No problem.
An apprentice. So I have to keep at this or Tutana will have my hide on the rack next. Bellows. The bellows sigh into the furnace and the coals burn brighter still. Come on, can I take this? That's okay? I can take that. Okay. Daily affirmations of focus and efficiency. 1. All errors can be reforged into lessons. Abaddon built himself from ruin. No setback is insurmountable. Not even death itself, so long as the soul is dedicated to the task. 2. Work hard, work well. Abaddon demands only honest labor and forthright service. All errors can be reforged if your first intentions are pure. 3. All ignorance can be reforged into knowledge. Master your craft. Excel at what you have been trusted to do. Do not offend your teacher by remaining a student forever. 4. Each generation must forge its successors. Teach your trade to all who are willing to learn, and in doing so, multiply the fruits of your knowledge. 5. All difficulties can be reforged into triumphs. Meet strife with humility and acceptance. Let adversity temper the ingot of your will, and you will never shatter. I really like this with the kind of... It's not really a double entendre, but it's pretty cool. It's liking every life experience, well, as far as learning and failing and trying again into, like a smith. 6. Embrace your station. Fulfill the duties of your rank and meddle not in the affairs of your betters. All guilds fail at the weakest link. 7. All loss can be reforged into strength. Profitable work heals all emptiness. So long as you have the tools of your trade, you will always be able to forge wealth anew. 8. Value the works of others, and they will value your works in return. Share the harvest with the hungry, and your tools with the destitute. 9. All souls can be reforged into whatever we will. Hard work is not exclusive to life. Death is no time for complacency. Commit yourself to excellence in this cycle and the next. Cool. As you may notice, I'm keeping all the books so far anyway. Alright, are we going to see more visions from these people? Duggan Steelcaller? Yep. You see a group of adventurers surrounded by a crowd of attacking Zorips. This man is with them, seemingly unconcerned by the battle, even detached from it as he stands in the middle of his comrades, chanting, his expression bordering on elation. His voice is powerful and deep, booming out across the combatants as a rich counterpoint to the chaos of their fighting. With every phrase the battlefield changes, his allies glow with a pulsing blue light, freezing the Zorps that surround them. A blazing pyre erupts from the ground, cutting and burning the creatures and sending them scattering. One of the fallen Zorps suddenly explodes as three giant grubs crawl from its corpse and attack the remaining enemies. That's awesome. The man continues to chant, thoroughly enthralled in the joy of the moment. Finally, the creatures have been reduced to one. His allies stand back as the man approaches it, still chanting. He removes his hammer and swings it at the Zorop. His phrase ends as the hammer connects with its head, punctuating the spell and bringing his song to an end. And Harlan Erwinson. You see a man crouching, surreptitious and alone, a series of untamed shrubs, all that hides him from the vision ahead. His eyes are locked on a Dilemgen, beautiful and terrible, eyes half-lidded as she hums. What's a Dilemgen? A bird with fantastic blue and orange plumage sits on her shoulder, trilling gently, and the man is entranced. Trembling, tentative, he stands, and the tranquility is broken by the bird's startled squawk. The Dilemgen half smiles, beckoning with twig-like fingers. She does not speak as she approaches. His mouth is dripping sounds of awe and admiration. She waits, coy and tempting, and with agonizing slowness, he is before her. Then something changes. She sees something hanging limply from his side and begins to hiss. Fingers suddenly claws and eyes black with hate. He has no time to reach for his axe or grimoire as she strikes. And just as soon as she strikes, she is gone, the only evidence of her existence, the shuddering wreck on the ground. He grabs at his grimoire, nevertheless, and begins to chant. But the words of a magical language of his own imagining, scribbled in a maniacal shorthand, ring hollow. And the silence continues unabated. He turns and shrugs at someone or something, if there is something there, you do not see it. Sheesh, what's all this stuff here? Here's Tuatano himself. This Omawa man is of an impressive build, towering above the countertop. His skin is the dusky blue of the deeper oceans, and his thick arms boast corded muscle. Small ears frame a square-jawed face coated in smeared soot and arcing black tattoos alike. He offers you a broad smile as you approach. Welcome. You're the first new face I've seen in quite some time. What can I do for you? Is this your shop? That it is. Been here near on 20 years now. Seen all manner of things over the years. Good luck and bad. Tuatano glances at the guard standing watch along the wall, but the black hammer smithery remains. What do you have here? You come to us at a strange time, I'm afraid. The stock's not what it used to be, but we find weapons and armor to offer yet, all forged right here at the Black Hammer. What happened? We just don't have the supplies. Been expecting the next delivery for near on a week now, and haven't seen a sign of it. Had to expect they were hit by bandits. The road out east is crawling with them. Or my workers ran off with the wagon themselves, maybe, to make some coin. Tutano snorts, as if that lot would dare. Alos says, he's right about the bandits. The dire situations in villages like this and the exodus to the cities has created far too many opportunities for unscrupulous sorts. Tutano scratches his jaw, thinking, if you happen to be headed that way, maybe you can keep an eye out for a supply wagon, or my shipment at least. They'd be cutting through the Black Meadow, I expect. Only good road for it. As it is, most of our weapons go to His Grace, Lord Radric. Tutano glances at the nearby guard. And that's as it should be, but it doesn't leave much for ourselves. We just don't have the iron. Where was the wagon traveling from? We send the wagon up to New Hiermar with weapons, and it swings around through Logholm and the like to purchase supplies. Shortest route back is through the Black Meadow, and then north through the wilds. Tutano shakes his head. Had a trader come through with word they'd made it to Logholm, but we haven't heard a thing since. I'll see them back safe and sound. I'd appreciate your trying anyhow. You bring back the supplies at least, and I'll have much more to offer you. A discount to start. And if you do find my workers, you give them a good smack upside the head for me.
Welcome.
Glad to see you again. Afraid we're still running low on goods, but you're welcome to look at what we have. You won't find finer anywhere else. What about camping supplies? How many camping supplies do I have? Hold on. Camping, we have two. We can have four at a time, I believe.
Well met, friend.
Look at that. Jenna's lance. Not actually a proper lance, but rather a pike. This weapon was gifted to an Orlan maid along with a goat by her wizard master Cabrindo, who was forced to show her the door after a number of episodes of remarkable clumsiness and brash carelessness that has left his grimoire waterlogged and his laboratory in ashes. The gifts were all the soft-hearted wizard could do to staunch his guilt. Wandering from place to place with only her goat, her pike, and a reputation for negligence that preceded her, her fortunes changed one day when she encountered a pair of soldiers trapped by a group of bandits. Too short to wield the pike properly, she instead climbed atop her goat and spurred it into the fray, leveling the pike into like a lance and running one of the bandits through. Frightened and confused by the display and intimidated by Jenna's coarse language, the remaining bandits fled, and the soldiers' lives were spared. Her actions earned her a commission with a local fort, and she served with distinction in the cavalry. The original experience had given her such pleasure that she always found a place at the front of any charge. Eventually, this took its toll, and she went missing after her unit was commanded to charge a group of trolls. Did she charge on a goat? Hold wall? A masterwork of dwarven craftsmanship, this sturdy arbalest earned its name during the Battle of Marching Mountains, where a dwarven ranger held off a group of ogres bearing down on him and his few remaining comrades. In the ranger's hands, the arbalest proved more than capable of launching bolts through thick ogre hide, holding the invading force at bay just long enough for reinforcements to arrive. While victory against the ogres proved short-lived, the tale is still one told with great pride around dwarven campfires. Ozareth Stiletto. Grants jolting touch. The War of Black Trees brought hardship and suffering to many Glenfathans, but it bore special tragedy for its druidic orders, who were forced not only to endure the deaths of many friends and kin, but also the destruction of the lands they revered above all else. Among these were Ozareth, a young Ovate. deeply troubled by the use of the elements to turn nature against the people of Ir Glanfath, and wondering if he was seeing the last days of his people, Osirith took to walking the endless stretches of burned-down forest in search of something, anything, that might signal a reason to hope. He found it in an old ironwood tree, thick and gnarled with roots that ran in waves to the ground as though they had been woven there. It stood as it always had, though singed well up the side of its trunk now, while everything around it had been incinerated by the soldiers of Dyrwood, leaving a wasteland 1,000 acres in every direction. Osirith plucked a single branch from the old tree, making sure to express his profound gratitude. An accomplished organic artificer, Osirith reshaped the branch into a blade that would rival any made in a forge. He infused it with the strength of the elements, vowing never again to be at their mercy, and resolving that the tree could endure. If the tree could endure, so too could he. In his hands, the blade would find its way into the hearts of many soldiers who stood at the edge of forests with torches and barrels of pitch, and by the war's end he had saved many forests from flame. When his years were drawing to a close, Osirith made a final pilgrimage back to the old ironwood tree, which still stood, and he laid the knife at its base to be taken up by someone else in need of inspiration in dark times. On his way there, he was pleased to see that beneath the ashes that covered the forest floor, new life had begun to spring. Osirith's stiletto is unusual, as the entire weapon is dark red-brown wood, even the blade. The magic used in its creation hardened and protected the wood, preventing it from chipping or warping. Dark green vines and leaves sprout from it and wrap themselves around the hilt to form the grip. That is interesting. The great sword is renowned for its ability to cause deadly wounds even against terrible beasts. Though it is a relatively slow weapon and requires the use of both hands, it is truly devastating when used by a skilled warrior. Warbow. The warbows are outnumbered by hunting bows in the Dyrwood. Warbows are more popular among professional soldiers and adventurers. With a high draw weight and respectable speed, they possess a power unmatched by magical implements, and they don't have the lengthy reloading times of crossbows and firearms. I should get one of these, maybe. I mean, he says he's going to get us a, you know, if we fulfill his quest, we'll, he'll give us a discount, but we need to, you know, survive to do this quest. So let's give him the crossbow. I'll take the warbow. A saber. Sabers are curved, single-edged swords. Curved swords. Capable of inflicting severe wounds, though they are less effective against armor than standard swords, they are deadly against unarmored enemies. Outworn buckler. This simple wooden buckler would not be out of place in a pile of surplus training shields. Painted green, it has two black iron straps across its front that form a large X. It looks as if it may have taken more than its share of blows and may have been in use for far too long. But far from ordinary, the buckler is in fact thousands of years old, its preservation a testament to a transcendence of its humble creation. The buckler originally belonged to one of the founding members of the Darkozy Paladini when she was just a squire, thousands of years ago in the glory days of Old Valia. As it accumulated damage from war and weather, the buckler became an extension of the paladin's own irrepressibility and protectiveness, as well as a symbol that inspired those in her charge. She wore it in every battle of her long and distinguished career, and though the paladin's name would eventually succumb to the ravages of time, the shield has yet to do the same. It is said that the shield was so partial to its original master that it would allow none but a paladin of similar conviction to touch it, and in times of need it has a way of making it into the hands of those whose souls mirror the greatest qualities of the Darkozy founder. Well, we don't have any paladins with us, and it's expensive. Actually, yeah, it's very expensive. Breastplates are popular for offering a modest amount of protection without the restrictive movement of the heavier mail and full suits of plate armor. Due to their widespread use by warriors from the Valian Republics, the fashion of clothing and padding worn under breastplates typically reflects Valian styles. Minor ring of deflection. Almost half my money, but I could technically buy it. Rings can feature plain bands or jewels in settings. Magical rings may bestow a variety of special properties or defenses on the wearer. Their small size allows their enchantment to complement similar enchantments from other items and spells, and this versatility has made them popular among adventurers. This is deflection plus 5. Oh, wait. Blunting belt. This belt is comprised of several layers of leather wound around small round pieces of metal. The resulting effect is not unlike brigandine, though the belt's sturdiness only reflects those arcane protections woven into the material, for the belt grants uncommon resistance against cutting and piercing weapons. Plus 5 damage reduction. For piercing and slashing. Yeah, I can't afford any of this stuff. Cape of Withdrawal. This is a standard cape, you know, text. Plus 15 defense when disengaging. Brown's Horn Figurine. Summon Animat. Though tarnished and lusterless in its remarkable age, the intricate inscriptions and texturing still discernible on the horn's surface, along with the artifact's obvious longevity, suggests an object of expert workmanship. A rope and grappling hook. Grappling hooks can be used to anchor a rope to locations that may be hard to reach by foot. Though often used to scale high walls, they have many potential applications. The usefulness of the rope is limited only by the imagination of the adventurer carrying it. Really? Who knows? We might need it. And a pry bar. Effective for prying open certain types of containers, but not especially useful on doors due to the uneven and narrow distribution of its leverage. Man, this guy. You never know when we're gonna need it, so. So we've got a war bow now. Hopefully she can use it. Crossbow is more damaging though. Speed slow. Speed average. An account of Tutano's sales. The pages are nearly empty. Poor guy. Maybe if he didn't charge so frickin' much. Fighters are extremely durable and among the most reliable damage dealers. They can be very effective at knocking down a position. Alright. So. Head to the windmill. We'll check that out next episode, I suppose. Oh, wait, what's going on? Swainer says, "We know there's more grain in there, Trumbull. We won't settle for scraps while you grow fat on our crops." A muffled shouting emerges from inside the mill. "The first of you drunkards comes through that door, gets a shot between the eyes. Gods hear me, Swainer. I'll put you down like a dog. Come away for now, lads. But we'll be back, Trumbull, and we'll have fair prices, or by the flame, we'll have a reckoning." I can't look at these people. Huh. Well, talk to this Trumbull guy next episode. Thanks for watching. See you next time. And a bang bang boogie, and don't stop the boogie.